Hey, it's Sunday afternoon at the shop at Jet City, and we're locked down. We're not really locked down. We're stuck inside because it's minus 15 Celsius outside. Too cold to ride the bike, but we're surrounded with most of our favorite machines, most of them. And we're going to do a little bit more orientation on the Allison 250 C18, which is so old it's not even in the general internet search results. You'll get the C20 and on up. The C18 was the first one, rated 317 horsepower versus 420, and the power generating section of the engine, the combustion, the turbines, the compressors, and the power turbine are well and fully capable of producing 420, but it's been derated because of the limits. I'm not sure if it's this gearbox, I can't see that being the case, but this feeds torque to the main helicopter gearbox. And various sources say the main helicopter gearbox in the early Bell Jet Rangers was limited to 300 and some horsepower, so this was derated to 320. That could be it, it could be this, I'm not sure. I'm not an Allison 250 expert, although I trained on one in school under the guidance of Jerome Gao, the instructor at BCIT, who this video is dedicated to. The whole series is dedicated to Jerome. He spent his whole life working on Allison 250s, and he is the man. He would be the greatest guy to host this video, but he's not here right now. So, here's the story. I don't own it. It's not my project, but it's happening in my shop. We're going to meet Justin later, I think, not today, and he is going to decide what work's going to be done. I don't know if we're going to be disassembling the core or the gearbox. Probably not the gearbox. Probably not the core. But what we're going to do is we're going to take all the accessories, like the fuel pump and fuel filter here, and refresh them. We're going to take them apart, inspect them, replace all the rubber seals and O-rings, and put them back together and make them like new. Anytime, anywhere we know of a seal or an O-ring on the engine, we'll be doing the same thing, but into the guts of the compressor and the turbine. That's not for me to decide, but I'm kind of thinking no, because it was running before it was put in storage 10 years ago. So we shall see. So right now we're not going to look in here. We're going to look at some bits. So, and also we're going to specifically take a look at the bleed valve. So hang on. As the fabrication of machinery continues next door. Okay, once again, this is one of my favorite books, the textbook I had at BCIT, learning about jets. And this is the Allison 250. This is the C20B, a very common one, but it's still a current helicopter engine. So if you want to buy one of these that's in running shape, you're looking at, I don't know, $35,000 and up, way up. So we're looking at total mass airflow, 3.8 pounds per second, whereas an LM1500 is 150 pounds per second. So that is a 15,000 horsepower engine. This is a 320 horsepower engine. So we're looking for, where's the compressor? Oh yeah, it doesn't say how many stages. It did somewhere else. Anyway, it's got a 6-stage compressor plus a centrifugal core. A centrifugal final stage. So this is a good layout of the way things are. This is the compressor, this is the turbine that drives it, and in a normal engine, whatever normal is, we'll take a look at a modern airliner engine for just a second, the CFM56. There's the high pressure compressor, there's the turbine, and then here's the turbine that drives the fan and low pressure compressor. So this could be called the power turbine, I suppose. So here they've kind of reversed it because they've got the, like I said before, the higher torque shaft is the bigger one, which is good. It's the way you want. It's got to handle more forces. And this little drive down here, this goes down to the output transmission, right? So what's not shown here is on the this, it's so strange for me to look at this because it's the backwards order from what I'm used to looking at. But this is the high pressure turbine or the compressor turbine. This is the power turbine or the low pressure turbine. The order is reversed. It's really strange. So, interestingly enough, the N number is the order in which air encounters the rotating bits of the engine. So N1 is the compressor turbine. And in a straight through engine, the N1 turbine would be here, but this is the N1 turbine, and that's the N2 turbine. Isn't that weird? So this is a diagrammatic representation of the way that the power gets out of the engine to the helicopter. Oh, here we go. Combination compressor, 6-stage axial, 1-stage centrifugal. And that's what I wanted to look at because we have some bits here. So if we're not gonna take this apart, probably not. We're gonna clean it as much as we can. I don't think we're taking the covers off. Maybe, maybe not, but we don't need to because we have some parts here. So back in the day when I was at BCIT, the British Columbia Institute of Technology, training on that engine, they were scrapping some parts, some beautiful parts. They've all been glass beaded to a shiny, shimmering satin finish. And what we have is the first stage of the compressor, of I think it's a C18, and it's got a little series of slots here. And this is a dual blisk. It's the spacers and the discs and the blades, all one piece. This has got to be expensive. Anyway, it's got a little nubbin right there that fits into, let's see, right there, fits together. So we have the first 3 stages of the compressor. Isn't that beautiful? It's all scrap because it's got some FOD to it, some corrosion and all that, but it does look beautiful being glass beaded. And I'm smashing it around like I shouldn't be. And I think this is the 5th stage because it's not the 4th stage. It doesn't quite fit. They weren't giving away whole rotors. I just grabbed what I could because everybody was like, we're all a bunch of crows. Oh, shiny stuff. I want that thing. I want that thing. So I didn't get the whole rotor. And that's okay. Anyway, these are the axial compressor. 1, 2, 3, and I think 5. So that's what's spinning inside there. All right, and one of the components, this is actually from our engine. It's all dirty and crusty and sticky and scummy. It was installed with silicone, which is bad. Should have a gasket there. We're gonna clean that off. What I'm going to do is I'm gonna clean this off by hand with brushes and solvent and just give it a surface cleaning. And then I'm gonna demonstrate the function of it, how it functions, which I'm really impressed with. And we'll do that once I clean it. Okay, so that's the compressor bleed valve, and it attaches to the compressor cases right there, and I believe it'd be the fifth or the sixth stage bleed valve. And you guys know why it's here, right? Why it's not up front, why it's back there. And you know what a bleed valve does, right? And if you don't, you need to watch my video called Compressor Stall. The bleed valve does things. It functions to eliminate compressor stall, and the way that it does it, you'll understand if you watch that video. And it's in the textbooks, but it's hard for me to understand, and it's in other textbooks only partially, because I don't think a lot of people actually understand exactly what's going on. I found 2 textbooks that explained it, but I had a hard time wrapping my head around what they were saying. So what I did is I spent literally years thinking about it and trying to come up with a simple way to explain it. And you can tell me whether I succeeded or not if you watch Jet Tech Compressor Stall. All right, so the bleed valve goes here. We're gonna clean it up and we're gonna demonstrate it. Hang on. Okay, this is take 2 because I forgot to turn the microphone on before. Now we got sound. So we've got the bleed valve assembly parts for the Allison 250. It's an hour later, yes, an hour, because we cleaned every last little bit, all the screws, everything. So how does it work? There's the piston, and this is the valve face. It's anodized aluminum, and it pushes against a stainless steel valve seat, I suppose. That's closed, that's open. So normally, the piston just floats around in the cylinder. There we go, just be gentle, there we go. Just rattles around. And it's blown in the open position because there's a larger piston area here than there is, say, in that smaller one. The piston, that's smaller than that, obviously. So it takes a lot of engine RPM to get to the point where basically you're at flight idle, and also the pressure after the 6th stage of the axial compressor equals greater than after the 5th stage, enough to force this closed. And once it does close, then the higher the engine goes in power, the more the pressure closing it is, and it just stays closed during engine operation. And you know why the bleed valve is open during the starting cycle, and then once you get to flight idle, it closes, because you watched the compressor stall video, didn't you? I know you did. It's a very long and, to some people, boring video, but it is that way to explain every step intuitively without any math or equations, really, some diagrams. And yeah, so the bleed valve, essentially, it doesn't unload the compressor, it helps to load the compressor. It prevents the axial compressor stages from stalling like a wing, an aerodynamic stall. Okay, so I'm just getting this on there. You having fun yet? It took me an hour to clean this. It's going to take me 10 minutes to put it together. And this is basically fully reconditioned. We've inspected for damage and wear and found none. Okay, we've got that. Now the air gets fed through here, through a constant flow orifice, into that passageway, sealed with an O-ring, a Viton O-ring, and it blows the piston down. So we'll demonstrate this once we get it back together. So we've got the O-ring in place. We've got this all cleaned up. We've checked, we've visually sighted through the orifice that it's not blocked, because if it was blocked, it wouldn't work. I'm gonna go like that. And we've got our freshly cleaned screws. I don't like slotted screws, but I'm not gonna change the fasteners. Put those in there with, they didn't have washers on them, and they weren't lockwired. We will lockwire them once we get this together. A little bit of anti-seize. That's what I like about even the oldest of parts of these engines are fully serviceable and stainless steel. Because I guess they were expensive in the first place, so you don't want to chuck them out. You want to rebuild them, if possible. Okay. So we took a picture of this before we took it apart, so we know the orientation is correct, but we also lined up the orifice with the passageway and the O-ring before we put it on there. And just hand tighten this. Then we can demonstrate it. It's not going to be, it'll be 98% reassembled, not 100%. Just to give that a little bit of a cinch. They weren't that tight. They don't need to be that tight. But they should be lock wired. Okay. Everything looks happy. Now, the bleed valve is normally open, but it can fall closed, but it'll be blown open by the slightest pressure. I've got an air supply here of about, I don't know, 40 PSI. Give it a bit of a... See that? Now that is held closed nicely. With possibly between a hard metal surface and a hard metal surface, the slightest of leaks, a hydraulic person would say, that's not a seal, that's a leak. But for air coming out of a compressor that's taking in almost 4 pounds per second of air, that's a seal. So cool. So once the engine gets to about flight idle RPM, maybe a bit more than that, the pressure from the compressor closes this. And okay, so months ago somebody said bleed valves are like VTEC, right? And I was gonna go, no, it's got nothing to do with piston engines. But really, if you think about it, the angle of the compressor blades is very aggressive, and it's like having, for example, it's like but not like, this is only a comparison, not a direct model, but it's like having cam timing for super high RPM. If you've got an engine that's best over 10,000 RPM, Is it going to start and is it going to run? It's barely going to run. It's barely going to start. And let's say you optimize the cam timing for 15,000 RPM and higher, 15 to 20. Well, then that engine's going to be really hard to start. And in a gas turbine engine, the angle of the compressor blades, the angle of attack, like this here, this is pretty aggressive. That's pretty aggressive. Look at that. Those things are really, really hauling. Okay, so if they were less angled, more even with you, then it would start beautifully, but you'd be giving up power at the top end of RPM. So you basically set the, it's not the timing, but you set the pitch of the compressor at a very aggressive angle, so it scoops a lot of air, but it has great difficulty turning slowly. So what the bleed valve does is it lets air out of there, doesn't unload the compressor, but it accelerates the air through here by reducing the pressure at the rear. So the air goes faster in. And what that does is it allows the very aggressive blades to work better. So in effect, by blowing air off at low speeds, you're increasing the loading of the compressor. You're making it work better. Anyway, once you get up to speeds where you're really moving, you can then close this valve. And it's like when VTEC kicks in your Honda, it makes a different sound and it makes a lot more power. So that's why the bleed valve is there. It's a starting bleed valve. And it is in a way, I suppose, I shudder to call it VTEC for turbine engines, but I guess it's a similar idea. Yes, it is. VTEC for jets. Okay, hang on. Alrighty, so what we need to do now is we're going to lock wire these bolts. We're going to reinstall this fitting for that line, but we need to put a new O-ring on it. So we need a little bit of grease on the O-ring, a little bit of happiness grease on our Vitone O-ring. And these O-rings essentially never wear out, but since we're disassembling this thing, and we're going to return it to service, it may as well be brand new everywhere instead of brand new in 98% of the places. Don't you think? Okay, and then this fitting needs to be lock wired as well. And that'll be that. Okay. There we go. That's our bleed valve. It's very simple. I like the fact that it's got one moving part. So very reliable. A little bit of a torque there just to make sure that we're all happy. All right. Okay, at the risk of me getting in your way or you getting in my way, we're gonna lock wire this thing. It's an odd shape. So I think we're gonna vise on the circular body up here. It looks to be the toughest part. So we'll do that. Okay, do it like this. Now, do we want to have that here or that here? We got to make our decision here. Over the top there. That's going to be difficult. Okay, this one will be good, that one will be crappy. All right, that's the way it goes. The relaxing process of lock wiring to space music. You can see I got a really long piece here because this is going to be easy. Actually, we're going to go from there, go around the bottom. We've got to come here all the way to there, and then out through there, and then to here and out there, and we'll finish it off here, which will be out in the open, which will be great. It'll be awesome. So let's just see how smart we are. I think we have to move this. I'm gonna have to move it here. Can you still see that? Yes, you can. Okay. So we're gonna get going. We're gonna get started. Yeah. Okay. Awkward angle. I don't want to move it too much. Okay, what I'm going to do is regroup here. Regroup. I'm going to do this. I can't really vise on anything. Okay, we'll start it from here. Right from there. You can still see what we're doing. We don't want to put too much force on things, because if we were to hear a crack or feel some deformation, it'd be a very sad day, because we would have to find another one or buy another one. We don't want to have to do that. Oh, this is really annoying. You need a really solid surface to be able to pull on the lock wire, and I can't seem to do that. Let's see. Oh, I can do that. Okay. Yeah, I can wedge it in there. Really want to be gentle but firm. Hey? Yeah? Okay, that's better. Because we're going to be coming underneath here. Underneath and around. Something like that. And we'll reposition again. Here. Let's see. Yes, we'll reposition to here. Now we've got to be extra careful. All right, so this, it's going to be that one. Now I've got to get this through there, which is going to be, oh, I guess not too bad. Bend it. Get ourselves going. Again, I need my special handy pliers. Hang on. These are one of my favorite tools. So if you're gonna set yourself up to do a lot of lock wiring, you want lock wire pliers, good ones. You want duckbill pliers for grabbing the wire and pulling on it, because needle nose, they suck at doing that. What the needle nose are great for, especially the bent nose, is reaching into places where your fat fingers can't fit. Or you can't fit your fat fingers. Like Homer Simpson, your fingers are too fat. To order a plus size keyboard, please mash the number pad now. Yes, where's the any key? Oh, I might have to cheat here. So here, we're gonna cheat. Cheat here, we're gonna loosen this off, get it started. With fingers, actually. Okay. There we go. And now we're gonna just get it started. See how the needle nose don't work? There we go. They don't work as great on pulling the wire as the duckbills do. So the duckbills are awesome. They just work like that. They're awesome. There. Now, I think I'm gonna do the time-honored over-the-top technique. Yep. Yes, it takes time. It does take a lot of time. The excitement of working on jets. Okay. Across the top. And then we'll come back. Oh, geez. Okay, if I was going to work on these engines on a regular basis, I would drill 3 holes in a piece of steel or metal that I could put in the vise. Since this is the only time I'm doing this, I'm struggling with the fact that the vise keeps moving. What are we doing here? We're just going to... There, I'll do it like this so I can pull the... You'll see. Okay. Now pulling this way. Should be a little better. Hopefully it doesn't tilt as much. It does still. And there, that's the one we're gonna feed through. I'm gonna cut the end off because it's hardened and bent. I'm gonna have nice, straight, smooth metal, so it's gonna go in there. I might have the same situation I did before. I do. Okay. Okay. A little bit of cheating. Didn't mean to throw that on the ground. Thinking too much about the camera. Okay. All right, so now we'll grab the screwdriver and the duckbills. Get that going. Tighten it up again. Like that. And see what happens. There, not bad. Okay, I'm gonna finish it somehow with, what am I gonna do? I don't know. I don't wanna grip it too tightly. I don't want it to slip. There we go. Okay. Put that on there. Now I think because I need a couple barrel rolls, I'm gonna finally go to the single pair twist, single pliers. And as always, my tails are over-tightened, over-twisted to make them stiffer and less likely to unravel. And that's just the way it is. Jerome would have taken marks off for that. Okay, and finally, the final score is run your finger over them, and if it slashes them open and draws blood, you lose a point. Okay, that's good. I've even got this going the correct way, so I'm happy about that. Okay, so we've got our fully overhauled bleed valve. And it would go on here, right like that. And so this obviously attaches to a 90 coming off this centrifugal scroll. So all of my babbling at the workbench was wrong. It's not the fifth versus the sixth stage of compressor fighting against each other. It's the fifth versus the seventh. So the pressure here, the centrifugal compressor is not going to be doing a whole lot till it gets really going. And once it does, it's going to really overpower the fifth stage bleed there, and it's going to close the bleed valve. Very cool. So I'll tag this as all parts replaced and cleaned, and I'll put this aside so we can continue on with the refurbishment of this thing. Yes, very cool. Okay, so we hear a lot of people talk about efficiency, and let me just show you some comparisons. The efficiency of an engine is best described by its thrust specific fuel consumption, TSFC, cruise, which is 92 to 98% RPM, 0.806 pounds of fuel per hour per pound of thrust. Okay, that's for the JT8D. This is an early low bypass turbofan, much more efficient than the turbojets. The J79 has a thrust specific fuel consumption of about 0.95, so higher fuel consumption. So a 20,000 pound thrust engine, or let's say a 10,000 pound thrust engine per hour would burn 10,000 pounds of fuel. That's a lot. So 0.806 is pretty high. Our little Allison 250, let's see if we can get in the view here. Allison 250 is 0.65, so that's better. Pretty efficient, not bad. But then we've got the PT6, the second most popular or numerous engine ever produced. Let's see, 0.59, that's pretty good. That's really good for a turboprop. But then a modern airliner engine, a modern high bypass turbofan, this would be used in the A330. And the 737, thrust specific fuel consumption is 0.38. So in the 0.3s is good, okay? So that's one third of a J79. So why is the PT6 designed in the late 60s and the Allison 250 designed in the mid 60s, why are they still so popular? And the answer is, you go with what you know. It's very reliable. It's an excellent engine. It took hundreds of millions of dollars to develop. And if you're going to build one of these helicopters, where are we? There we are, one of these helicopters. Are you going to go with an untried new engine from some manufacturer that you've never heard of before? Or maybe you have heard of before, but it's a new engine. Are you going to be the first one to adopt that? Or are you going to go with the tried and true Allison 250, Rolls-Royce 250, that's been around for 40, 50 years, has hundreds of millions of flight hours, and has proven to be a robust, rugged, and extremely reliable engine? What are you going to do? You're going to take an experiment and gamble the company, or are you going to go with what you know? That's why these engines, these are two of the most reliable engines ever made. Now, the competition for this engine, I don't know what the competition for this is. There might be a few European engines, but the competition for the PT6 is the Garrett TPE 331, which is also an excellent engine. That's a different type of engine, which we have gotten into in other videos, and we may in the future. But anyway, the TPE 331 and the PT6 are both, it's kind of like the Ford 302 and the Chevy 350. They're very, very, very well-established, reliable engines out there. Not the most economical, but good. Same thing as this. That's actually 0.65 pounds per hour is I don't know, it's a little high, but it's got such a history of reliability behind it. It's like buying gold. That's what it is. The gold standard of small helicopter engines. All right. So when this thing is done, I think the plan is we're going to make it look nice. But originally, the first plan was just to get it running and leave it looking like this. And that was going to be a good candidate for a boat maybe called the Rat Jet. But I think it's going to get cleaned up. So if anybody's got an idea that we happen to like for a name for it, let us know. I think... we might make a contest out of that. I'm not sure what the prize will be, but we'll think of something. So send in your names and the names for the boat. And if I like it, if Justin likes it, if we agree that we like it, we will contact you and let you know that you've won the contest. But this is just the beginning. So this is one component overhauled. And thanks for watching.